Hello everyone, welcome back to my isolation station, my home studio here in Bristol. It's time for another episode of the Travelxp podcast. I'm your host today, Jamie Lowe, and I'm joined by Cong Chen, who is all the way in Canada. Cong, how are you doing today?
I'm well, how are you?
I'm fantastic. So why don't you give me and the audience a little bit of a brief on who you are and what you're all about?
So yeah, just a quick intro. I live in Calgary. I have mostly grown up here, and I went to school in Montreal and Quebec, so that's like more the middle of Canada, and then I came back here to Calgary after school, and I kind of just got really obsessed with traveling. It's definitely an addiction.
From the people that I know that live in Canada or who've spent any amount of time in Canada, a few of my older family members worked there for a period of time, I think you get the sort of outdoorsy bug from living in a place like that, because there's so many breathtaking landscapes sort of all over the place.
You would think so, but I don't think I got my travel and exploring bug here, which is really, I think actually what happened was I got really obsessed with exploring different places and things abroad. I came home and I actually started, I would say not too long ago, I started exploring near home, like maybe 2015 I started, so.
Oh, right. Oh, that's cool. Yeah. So since we're on the topic then, let's get us started on where your journey with travel began. What was it that inspired you and started it all?
Well, my first like trip abroad by myself was when I was 21 to Peru. And I think it started there because I just realized like not traveling with your parents, it's so much more different. And I had never gone outside of Asia and like North America. So Peru just kind of opened my eyes to how much more there is in the world and just how different and how amazing people are in different countries.
I think that's what attracts me to going to different places. Like the places that are on my bucket list are the ones that are sort of the furthest away from my culture, my own culture. I like to experience something completely different. And Peru and large parts of South America are on my list too. But what was it about Peru that drew you to that country first?
It was actually a volunteer trip. So So we had set up like medical clinics. So it's mobile medical clinics in really small towns around, I guess they call them like communities. Mm-hmm. They're not really cities. They're just like towns and communities in like rural Peru. So it kind of got decided for me, but I was really happy that it was there.
And you sort of alluded to it there. You work in the healthcare profession. So for people listening and watching along, Cong is also a nurse. And I think it's time we take a minute just to thank you and all the other frontline workers who are doing such fantastic work in this whole crazy situation that we're in right now across the world. But what's it been like for you in your work during the pandemic?
Definitely have gone through some difficulties in a really short amount of time. So I think we're hanging in there. But I think that it definitely has taken a toll on everybody.
Yeah, I was speaking to someone today in the UK who's campaigning for better mental health support for healthcare workers over here.
Yeah.
Because, I mean, you know, it is your job, but when it's like this, it's you know, I don't think anyone can just expect you to carry on and get over it. So hopefully there's something like that for you over there in Canada. But of course, something that you probably do to, you know, really let loose and get away from everything is to go exploring and to go traveling. And that's something that, you know, is probably an equally as big as a passion to your nursing career.
I would say that's exactly how I deal with stress, is to go explore. And things like, I find that things like diving and just yoga, those are things that I kind of gravitate towards when I go traveling. And yeah, they're definitely good for your mental health.
So is there a connection then between yoga and diving? Because when I think of yoga, you know, you're very zen, but I mean, not for me. When I do yoga, I'm one of the those guys that vibrate, and I'm, you know, I'm, my brain isn't on my breathing at all. I'm still very, I'm a little yoga baby, doing my best to improve. But then I, when I think about what I should be feeling when I'm doing yoga, and then I guess what you feel when you're diving, when you're sort of completely cut off from the world, it's quite quiet, and you're sort of just like floating there in this sort of ecosystem. Is that the sort of the same sort of feeling, do you reckon?
So it's like, I don't know if you meditate, but it's kind of like mindful meditation for an hour or however long you're diving or doing yoga. Like, I just love like the silence between people, but then you have sounds of like nature and whatever's under the ocean. Mm. So that's exactly what it is for an hour. It's just about you enjoying your hour and like shutting your mind off, basically. So
were there any sort of barriers for you getting into diving? Were there any sort of fears, or, you know, in England you have to do a certain set of qualifications to be able to dive, and I'm guessing it's the same over there with you guys.
I started diving, I think, when I started really backpacking. So I think that, well, I've always wanted to be able to breathe underwater. And I've been really lucky. Like, I know a lot of, because I also have my dive masters, so I'm able to take people diving as a guide. And so I know that your body, some people's bodies just kind of react differently to certain situations. And events underwater are stressful, because if you can't breathe, it's your body is like, hey, you need to get out of here, or else you might actually be in a lot of trouble. So I've been really lucky, but I definitely know that there are a lot of people who have sort of like tendencies to kind of panic. And so I think that would definitely be something that would be a challenge if you wanted to go diving.
But the thing that really stops me from enjoying the sea completely is I am so squeamish about the wildlife down there. I think it stems from almost being stung by a jellyfish in Cornwall in the southwest of England when I was very, very young. And ever since that, I've just thought the sea's got so many things that could kill me. And even if it's just like a harmless little fish that brushed up against me, that would cause me to sort of like, you know, freak out a little bit. So I think I'd be tense as a diver. But I'm sure you come across that a lot, because, you know, it's not the place that we're used to being so many meters down there in the water. So how do you deal with someone like that when you're taking them on dives?
Honestly, I can't say I've had like a client that doesn't like fish or is like kind of scared of them coming near them, because then they probably wouldn't go diving. But I would say, like, for example, if you were to come on a dive trip and wanted to go diving, I would say just try it. Like, what's the worst that can happen? Oh, or maybe like, oh, sorry, that's my cat. Have you tried snorkeling?
Yes, done snorkeling. I went to, I think it was at like a sort of water park, and there was a bit where you could snorkel through, and there was loads of fish and people were going down, but I was staying very firmly at the top. I'm interested and I like to look at them, but I just keep my distance. I don't know what it is about the feeling of something in the water touching me. There's a funny story, actually. I was diving off a sort of diving platform in Biarritz in France, and I dived into the water, and then I felt something brush against me. I was very young. I think I was only about 14, 13 at this time. And I start going insane. I completely freak out. I'm thrashing my arms about and I'm saying, get away, fish, get away, fish. I couldn't really speak French at that moment in my life, so I was probably saying something about the poissons, but I can't remember what. And then I turn round and I see this, like, I don't know, someone's mum, sort of like bobbing under the water, dodging my wrists as they were flailing about. That's sort of how freakish I am around fish. But yeah, I think it's something that I've got to overcome. Do you reckon you could handle me on a dive?
I think so.
I'm not going to hold you to it. Don't worry.
I was going to say something about, so like I kind of understand if I were to like touch, like go into murky water and was touching like something slimy, I'd be like, what is that? Or, you know, but I think the ocean is just so much wider. And just so you know, I have never been touched by, okay, one time, like one of those remora, like the fish that like to suck on things,
Oh.
the ones that like stick onto whales, one of those came and like was stuck on me, but I've never been touched by a sea creature. So if that's any reassurance, they don't like people. So
Okay, that is,
they
you know,
won't.
that's, but we'll leave diving there for now, because I want to get back to just general traveling and how you manage it all. Because working as a nurse, we all know, especially through these times, how much pressure is on healthcare workers like yourself, and how many hours really that you're expected to work. So how do you manage to balance that with being able to go all around the world? Because that's one of the top excuses for people who don't get to travel to the destinations that they've always wanted to, is because they can't fit it in. But you manage it. How?
In the hospital, I work basically part-time. So my schedule is a part-time schedule. So I don't work the full, like full-time. I think it's like over 40 hours or something. So it's like I can pick up enough shifts to fill up to full-time, or I can stay part-time. And then also with shift work, you can swap. So what I do is I swap shifts with my coworkers so they can go on trips and then I can go on trips. And then I also have what I do with my vacation time and my like overtime, which is like when you pick up an overtime shift, I guess, suppose you can use it as vacation time. So that's what I do. And then whichever, like if I want to stay longer and I don't have enough paid vacation or time off, what I do is I ask for like unpaid time off. To me, it's worth it because I work as much as I can when I'm home. And if I can still get paid while I'm abroad by using like paid, I'm okay with having like a couple weeks unpaid. So I think I'm super lucky because I've talked to a lot of like backpackers and stuff. And people don't have, like, I would say in North America, the typical amount of vacation time per year is about 2 weeks.
Really?
So, like 10 days.
It's at least 4 weeks, or about 35 days, not including bank holidays over here. So yeah, that's not a lot, is it? But
No.
I think the point of it is you've got to be able to plan it, and that, I think, is what sort of sets you apart from maybe the average person that goes on one sort of holiday or trip a year, is that it takes a lot of forethought to be able to think how many hours you've got to do, how many hours you've got to swap, how many shifts you've got to sort of trade with other people to ensure that you can have enough time to go on these trips. But that's because it's such a big part of your life. I mean, if, for example, if my uncle plays golf, let's say, and he makes sure he plays golf, and he makes work around his golf, because that's one of his, favorite pastimes, and that's just what travel is for you.
That's exactly what it is. If you, I find that if people make the effort to make the time, then they do. Or if they want to save the money, they can. But it all depends on how badly do you want to go. Because if you want to go somewhere, you will do anything. Like you will stop eating out, you'll, save your money.
I think that's it, isn't it? And with travel destinations, a lot of people sort of think that some destinations just will never be open to them. They'll never be able to get there because of the job they work, or the hours they work, or their situation that their life's in. But I think, that's if you've got a bit of inspirational guidance to give, it's that, you can get there. You've just got to put however much work it will take, and then, maybe you'll get one step closer. I think what people do is they sort of default into thinking, oh, I'll never get to there, so I'm just not going to bother trying.
Because I've been there too. I've been like, oh, like how am I supposed to go to all these places and do all these things that I want to do? But I'm more of a, like, I don't think before I do a lot of things. And I think that's maybe, It gets me in a lot of trouble, but it also, I think if I didn't do that, I would be very hesitant to do a lot of the things that I've been able to do.
But have any of your travel plans been affected by the pandemic at all?
Yeah, it's been, because when I am here, what I do is I tend to think about all the places I want to go. And that's kind of like how I keep myself like sane in the, working as a nurse, because it is high stress. And not being able to plan or just like even be like, oh, I could go here next month or next week, or it's been hard. And we don't know when it's going to start again, really. Like I have a couple of friends who have booked flights for November. But I'm like, as much as I want to book a flight, I'm so hesitant just because of the situation. And, so yeah, it's been, now I'm trying to think into next year and maybe be more optimistic about next year instead, but it's just kind of, it's everything is canceled. I had come back from Hawaii just when everything was kind of getting serious. So even coming home from Hawaii, like it was still pretty crowded in airports and not a lot of like mask wearing or anything, but I think it was very soon after that.
So I guess I had a trip at the start of the year similar to you, and I when I'm not traveling or podcasting for Travelxp, I am a journalist, a news reporter here in the UK, and I remember getting back from my ski trip in Morzine in France, and we were talking about something going on in the Far East. There were bits of news coming out, and then when I got back, we started talking about it in the news here in England, and then since then we've not stopped. And it hit me the other day that I got back. I went to France to ski on the 2nd of January. When I got back, I was talking about the pandemic and the possibility of a lockdown and all that sort of stuff. And now here we are in May. I think it's probably because of the job that I work in. I've just been consumed by it for so long. But I seem to have just like transported, like fast forwarded to this point in the future. And so many months have just been swallowed up by this whole thing. When I think back to skiing, it feels like last week, but in reality it was several months ago. Does that feel the same for your trip?
Yeah, you're not alone. I the other day at work, I thought it was March. I was like, what date is it? It's March. And then my co-worker just looks at me and I'm like, it's not March. It's almost June. So
that's the thing that's really freaking me out. It's like, where's the time gone? I mean, I don't feel like I'm overworking myself, but I am sort of consumed by this sort of topic right now. And I think that's probably a little signal to get back to talking about all the beautiful destinations that you've been to in your life. So where has been your favorite place that you've ever traveled?
Australia. The Philippines. And South Africa.
Very good. Great destinations. None of them have I been to. I haven't been to any of them. But yes, one of those is definitely on my list. Philippines, absolutely. Now I want to get into what you got up to in those countries. So any standout memories or maybe those funny holiday anecdotes that you alluded to earlier on?
I would have to pinpoint, every day is hilarious because you run into so many like different people and situations that you would never encounter, I guess, like from your day to day. I was thinking more like something that I would remember that was so heartwarming.
Yeah, go for that then. I think people need something like that in their lives right now.
Or the moments that stick in my memory are the ones that where strangers will just come and help me. So, like I've had locals offer to have me stay at their place because they see that I'm at an overnight layover in a foreign country, and they're generally like worried about me. So I've had people offer to, literally let me stay at their place. And then they're like, well, I'm coming back in the morning to work at the airport, so I can just drive you back. So things like that. But one time in India, we were at the Taj Mahal, and I did a horrible job wrapping my sari. I like watched a YouTube video maybe 5 minutes before we left, because we had to catch the sunrise, and saris are hard to wrap. So when we got into the like the Taj Mahal air, like the entrance, these three ladies saw that I was literally like struggling with my sari, and it was like falling off, and they stopped, and I wish I could have like communicated with them, but they were obviously, I think they were speaking Hindi, so we were able to kind of communicate just like with like sounds and hand motions. So they literally unwrapped everything. Like under the sari, you do have clothes on, so it's fine. But they literally just like, they didn't even say hi or anything. They were like, no, this is not, no. And so they like took everything off and rewrapped it. And I was just like, oh my goodness, like these three ladies took their time to rewrap my sari, and it's not an easy job. And they were like using their own pins and stuff. So I just think that will be one of my top memorable moments.
And obviously you come into contact with lots of people that you don't know, because you do travel largely on your own, don't you?
I do. I have tried traveling like with friends. It just, I feel like it's harder because you meet less people. And I think that if you travel with friends, it's good. But if for me, I don't always like the same things that other people want to do. So I really need that freedom to be able to go on a dive trip and or go do yoga or go hiking. And if my friend doesn't want to come, they might get offended. So the beauty of traveling alone is you go to a hostel or you just meet people that want to do the same things as you. If you don't want to, that's fine. So everyone goes, does their own thing a whole day, and you come back and you talk over dinner at the hostel about your day. And yeah, I just find that it's just a lot more freedom to travel alone. And you're never alone. Like, I'm never alone. If I want to be alone, I can be. And then if I want to be around people, I can be. So.
And of course, you've got a huge network of people as well. Your own sort of online audience. I'm sure that when you get into different countries, do you, you know, ask for recommendations or try and, you know, meet up with people that you might have spoken to in sort of various different scenarios online?
Definitely. I love the travel community that we have on Instagram. I feel like it's just so convenient to have people who are from certain cities and countries, so they're the experts, and I can just ask on my Instagram, does anybody have any recommendations? And there's definitely like a community of travel bloggers that support each other, and we go on trips together, and so yeah, it's really great. So you're never really alone. And then there's also like the old school way of meeting people is just talking to them.
So how do you think travel is going to change when we are out the other end of whatever, you know, this situation ends up being, whether we're, you know, breaking free of a lockdown or we are living in a new normal? How do you think the travel industry will change going forward?
I think that we will see exactly how it's going to change when things start running again. But I think that a lot of smaller companies, like tour companies, which are the companies that I usually go for just because they're smaller and more kind of intimate with smaller groups, if I do go with like a tour group. And then I think there's going to be a lot less flight options. And I think there's also going to be a lot more, I guess, health checking at the airport. So it's going to take a lot more time. And I think it's going to be really difficult.
So one more question about the travel world before we touch on a little game. What do you think is going to change about environmental sustainability and travel? Because now that the travel industry has paused for a bit, there is a bit more time to think and implement new things when it starts up again to lessen the impact on the environment. Is that something that's important to you?
I have maybe been environmentally conscious my entire life or something, but it honestly was only brought to my attention when I did my dive master's in Utila in Honduras. Just seeing the beaches there filled with garbage and actually cleaning it was kind of what opened my eyes up to just how much garbage there is in the ocean and on beaches, and it doesn't go anywhere. Plastic doesn't, it doesn't go anywhere, and it's also really difficult to recycle. So I think that since that this whole pandemic has kind of stopped everything, it will be easier for us to restart and do things a little bit differently. So I would hope that it would encourage people to be more environmentally friendly. But I also know it's difficult just because it is cheaper in a sense to use plastic. And but I think that you're right. A lot of us do have a lot more time now to do a little bit, maybe some life reorganizing. And I do find a lot more people are reaching out to me and asking me if I have any tips on how to, I wouldn't say waste free is very difficult, but definitely working towards less waste.
Good stuff. Well, before we go, I want to play a little game with you. So
Okay.
I'm going to ask you to pick one of these options. Now, some of them are going to be fairly difficult for you to choose, but I'm going to ask you to. So the first one is, would you prefer to be a nurse or a traveler? You can only pick one.
Oh man, I guess traveler.
Perfect. Would you prefer to travel in the beach or the mountains?
Oh, you are asking me really hard questions here. Beach.
Beach. I think I'd side with you on that one. So, backpacking or luxury travel?
Backpacking.
Yeah, you are a backpacker through and through. So, would you prefer to be tasting street food or eating in high-end restaurants?
Street food.
Lovely stuff. Oh, I'm not sure. I don't know. I think I like my little fine dining. I think I'll differ with you on that one. Now, would you rather swim with dolphins or dive with sharks?
Oh man, can I pick both? I really can't. Swim with dolphins.
I think that's a safer option. Would you prefer to have the magical power to freeze the moment or time travel? So, freeze the moment to enjoy it more or experience different eras.
Definitely freeze the moment.
Would you prefer to go to the ocean floor or outer space?
Well, you just hit another thing that I want to do on my bucket list.
What, go to the ocean floor?
No,
Outer
outer
space.
space.
Oh, cool. That's on my bucket list too. I have a savings account that's called Ticket Out to Outer Space. Will we ever get there? We do not know. And then the last question I've got for you is summer or winter?
Summer.
Summer. I'm with you on that one. Well, that was a good way to wrap up this chat. So, Cong, thank you very much for taking the time to talk to me today. Have you got anything else that you'd like to say to our viewers?
No, I just maybe just hang in there. Everything is going to get better eventually, and everything will eventually, it will be different, but it will get back to some sort of normal.
I think I'll join you on that one. But thank you so much for joining us today, Cong. Your work is certainly inspiring so many people. I'm sure everyone who is trying to travel alongside managing their careers will definitely take a look at your social media profiles and take away some tips. Make sure you check out Cong's work on social media and don't forget to check out other interviews from this series on TravelXP's Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. This is Jamie Lowe in Bristol and Cong Chen all the way in Calgary signing off. Bye bye.